Once upon a time, the infamous rover Renardo plundered the floating isles. Then his mother called him to her deathbed. "Swear to me that you won't die on the gallows," she rasped. Reluctantly, he swore. And he whiled away his days at home with music, cards, and wine. But the Emperor had changed. He'd been good once, a shy, almost humble toad. He'd built universities. But then people started whispering about mass graves in the woods. Midnight rituals, victims screaming. The Imperial Ravens would round up entire villages, and no one ever returned. The Ravens had come to Ubar scouting for ancient books said to be of great power. But the librarians had hidden the books, so they'd burnt the librarians. The citizens, outraged, had driven them off. The Ravens had come back with dropships. The kid had fled with one of those books. He was brave and dumb and wanted to join the rebellion. And Renardo had promised his mother he'd protect him. The kid was looking down, watching his city burn. "Sorry, kid," Renardo told the kid. "Look, if we give them the book, they'll leave you alone."
"My mother died for this book!"
"I promised her I'd protect you." Oh, damn it. The kid had run off. With the book, of course. So Renardo had to run after him. The two ravens were staring at the kid like he was their dinner, which probably was what was in their tiny brains. "Hey," Renardo said. They cocked their heads at him. "Pick on someone as ugly as you." Wait, that didn't come out right.
"For the Emperor!"
The ravens cawed and rushed at him. Dropship flew overhead. He hoped they hadn't noticed him, the kid. The Gate of Heroes. Someone's idea of a joke, making the Skyship Docks a gated community. You needed a hero's sword to open it. And the kid was on the other side of the gate.
"Who let you through?"
"Promise me you'll take the book to the rebels, or I'm gonna steal your ship."
"I'm not taking that damn book anywhere, and neither are you."
"Try and stop me," laughed the kid. "I bet you don't even have a hero's sword."
And with that, the kid hopped away. Had to hand it to the kid. He was an idiot, but he had guts. Where was Renardo going to get a hero sword? Ore and wind essence? That sounds about right. Perfect. Hero Sword, QED. This is what he got for settling down and finding people to care about. The kid's mum had been a swell cook, and she'd laughed at Renardo's jokes, even when he didn't know he'd made one. And then the ravens had come to burn her. And she'd made him promise to protect the kid. But she never told him where the book was. Just the kid. He came up to a ledge. It was too far to jump. There'd been a bridge here before, hadn't there? And there was Peter, giggling at him.
How'd you get across? He asked the kid. Where'd you find a hook?
I harped,
said the kid.
Wise-ass kid.
Hey, look out behind you!
Cute, said Renardo. Ah, ravens. It was time to talk some sense into the kid. Just hook his way across the ledge and chase the kid down. Thing was, he hadn't used his hook since he'd retired. He'd done it. Maybe if he meditated at that altar there, he'd remember his old skills. Starting to come back to him. Something you never completely forgot, like how to freeze time when attacking. The more he fought, the more he'd probably remember. And there was the Farfarer. She was the fastest ship he'd ever known. She could do the Kestrel run in 12 furlongs. Oh, so the salesman told him. And something told him the kid was about to walk into an ambush.
Stop! He shouted. I'm not giving you the book! Shouted the kid, and took off. No! Peter!
But the kid ran for it. And a goggler nailed him with its eye beam. The book was unburned. Next to it were the buckles from the kid's shoes and a kid-sized pile of ashes. Damn it, why hadn't he lied and told the kid he'd take the book to the rebels? The kid would be alive now. Really pissed off and betrayed, but alive. Oh, damn it. Renardo picked up the book. He couldn't let the Empire have it now. He was going to have to get it out of there. He'd be a wanted man. Probably have to join the rebellion just to have a place to dock. Well, he'd hated home life anyway. What was the big deal about this book anyway? Maybe he should open it and find out. All that had been years ago. How many? War was a blur, and now three Raven scout ships were chasing him.
Where are you running, rebel?
Cawed the Raven captain over the loud hailer. Renardo could see them cranking up their catapults.
Just going out for milk?
Renardo yelled back.
Where can you run?
Laughed the Raven horribly. Far behind him, another city was burning. The dark cloud above its island was thousands of Imperial ships. The fleet was doing a thorough job.
Take us to the rebel base, and we'll spare your life!
It called. The entire jury-rigged rebel fleet was only a few islands to the east. Beyond that were only the pillars of heaven. A sea of endless blood-colored tornadoes. The rebellion was out of time. Unless Renardo could bring a game-changer. Maybe he could. Renardo had found out where he could find the pieces of the Sky Ripper, the legendary weapon that had exiled the lost gods. Surely a legendary weapon could win the final battle. On the other hand, his old friend Lupino had sent Renardo a desperate message saying he had a brilliant scheme to save the rebellion. If Renardo could only rescue him. Renato dived the Farfarer towards the abyss. As he felt the heat of the jet stream, the Raven ships peeled off, not stable enough to follow him down there. Now it was time to choose. Lapino or the Sky Ripper? Apparently, the mad rabbit had sold a Pegasus that he did not exactly own. Lapino always wiggled out of trouble, given time. But he was out of time. The Ravens had figured out that Lapino was a rebel spy. If the fleet reached him first, they'd string him up for that. Never mind the winged horse. Lapino had apparently managed to confuse the judge by arguing that he hadn't actually stolen a winged horse. He'd only sold it. But wait, where was the prison? The village was empty. Had everybody fled the Ravens? Don't look down, he told himself. Don't look down. People were frightened these days. Just 2 weeks passed, Renato had sneaked through an empty town and listened to the Raven's call about the Emperor's new taste in ritual sacrifice. Renato's blood was up. He just needed to smash something. Wasn't that good yet? Just agree to disagree, said Renato. No? Ravens were landing everywhere. The advance guard. He'd better get moving. If they got to Lapino first, they'd eat him for breakfast. Or a snack. Ravens weren't picky. If they got hungry, they sometimes forgot to interrogate their prisoners. Even top spies like Lapino. Where had the mad rabbit got to? Starting to come back to him. Something you never completely forgot, like how to freeze time when attacking. The more he fought, the more he'd probably remember. Feeling a bit peckish. Ready to take our new powers. Dirty and bloody, Renato finally reached Lupino. The rabbit was practicing his shuffle. Bernardo recognized the cards. It was Lupino's favorite deck. Oh, I thought you were in danger. I am. The ravens are coming. Oh, the prison thing. Right, yeah, we see this guard owed me 53 ducats, so we made a deal. They're very reasonable people, actually, for weasels. Now, I got a brilliant plan to kidnap Zenobia. We capture Zenobia, we find out what she knows, and that's the whole war right there. Easy peasy, lemon squeezy. Capture the Emperor's greatest general, who also happened to be a deadly sorcerer and, oh, his only daughter? That would be worth it. On the other hand, he could still get to the core of the Sky Ripper, even if he couldn't get the whole thing. It must have great power. Zenobia wasn't just the Emperor's daughter, of course. She'd been Renato's best friend in Swordfu school. And you're still mad for her, the rabbit reminded him. They'd been close. She'd told him things no one else knew. But she'd never told him who she really was.
She knows all the Emperor's plans, chuckled the master spy.
She won't give them up easily.
She'll tell the interrogators, all right. Said Lupino.
Taking her would change the game, all right. The city was already under Zenobia's control. I had to admire her efficiency. Renato shivered at the thought of Zenobia at the mercy of the interrogators. Could he really turn her over to them? But this was war. It wasn't meant to be pretty. sword. Ice wall. Ice cube. Most people still use doorknobs. So, what's this plan of yours? Use me as bait, said Lupino. And he outlined a slightly complicated plan that involved geese, a net, setting the farfare a little bit on fire, Lupino dressing as an old blind toad, and Renardo hiding inside a monstrous watermelon. What could possibly go wrong? Thought Renardo. Oh, this is gonna be fun, said Lupino, as he ran to go set up his marvelous plan. If I craft a sword now, it's going to be really short. Renardo felt dubious about the whole plan. With every step, he was waiting for it all to go horribly wrong. But against all odds, Lupino's idiotic plan worked. Zenobia's ravens ran off after the geese, the net dropped, and Renardo jumped out of the watermelon and put his sword to Zenobia's throat.
Renardo, she said, are those new scars? They look good on you.
You never return my velvet jacket. It was my favorite.
You look stupid in velvet.
Oh, what does an imperial princess know about style? Oh, get a room, you two, said Latino.
But the fleet was coming on fast, so they put Zenobia on the Farfarer and took her east over the Nexus.
She'd vanished from Swordfu School, from his life, without even saying goodbye, without ever telling him she was the Emperor's adopted daughter. Ah, Lupino was right, Renardo thought reluctantly. She knows things. She recognized his look. You're taking me to the interrogators, aren't you? She said, wide-eyed. And then she jumped, with horror. Renardo saw Zenobia plummeting. Then he saw the Nexus below them. Cats always land on their feet.
Ah, oh, she'll head for the Imperial outpost, yelled Lupino. You have to catch her.
Cats can run faster, but foxes can run longer. If he ran, he could head her off before she reached her minions at the outpost. Well, he did love a good chase. if they didn't want their things broken, they really ought to make them stronger. Bridges, anyway. I wonder what I could make with all these sword crafting materials, thought Renardo. He was closing on her. He could smell her fear. He tried not to think about the interrogators at the secret base. What did they do to her? Maybe it didn't have to end that way. Maybe he could talk to her. But, after all, there were worse things the Imperials had done to friends of his. A crafting bench. Renardo wondered what he could make with it. Renardo reached the outpost.
The Imperials there were no match for him. Soon after, Zenobia limped up the path. When she realized he was already in front of her, she didn't even try to run.
Oh, you left without saying goodbye.
Again, he said, please. I'm enjoying this a little too much. She said, shaken.
Oh, spare us the chit-chat, would you?
Said Lapino as he shackled her hands so she couldn't throw spells.
She knows all his plans.
All the way back to the Farfarer, Lapino nagged Renato about how the interrogators would pry all the intel out of Zenobia. How that would turn the tides in the imminent battle. All they had to do was take her to the Rebel's secret base. Renato didn't like to think about what the interrogators would do to her. Couldn't he just talk to her? Away from the Nexus, Renato could see the fear in Zenobia's eyes. I can't take it to those creatures at the base, he whispered to Lapino.
Ah, you've gone soft. Soft in the head. We captured her for what she knows.
I'll take her to the mountains, tell all the horrible things the Emperor's done. Yeah, believe me, she'll turn. And he turned the wheel.
The hell you will,
shouted Lapino, and he grabbed the wheel back from him. The two of them wrestled for control of the ship. It shot off like a mad sparrow. Suddenly, Renato was falling. When he came to, Zenobia was standing over him.
Why didn't you take me to the base to be interrogated?
She demanded.
Do you know what's left of people they interrogate? This is some trick, isn't it? To make me fall for you again. Well, I won't.
Oh, go on then. Scurry back to your ravens. I can't stop you. But strangely, she didn't. As Renato set off to find the Farfarer, she followed him, keeping just out of sight of the ravens. What were these poles exactly? Parking meters from the time of the lost gods? Definitely easier to fight inanimate objects. This thing really needed a roof.
Ah.
As Renato stopped to sniff the wind, Zenobia came up, still mad.
Did you really think you'd just talk me into betraying my father?
Oh yeah, sure, that was exactly my plan.
Then why aren't you even talking to me? Because I've never talked you into anything in my life. They're gonna court-martial you for letting me go.
He caught a whiff of the Farfarer. Wet rope, tar, and a cask of Scoble ale he'd spilt last year. It was that way. Renato's paws were getting numb. Calaveras really didn't want company, did he? Renato wondered if he should have taken Zenobia to the rebel base for real. Maybe she wasn't playing him after all. After the bleak talk about the Emperor's dark secrets, he was regretting his suspicion. Sure enough, the Farfarer had crashed in some rocks. There was no sign of Lupino. Zenobia caught up.
All that kid stuff in Swordfu school. Look, that's the past. We're adults now. We have duties to other people. We have destinies. What are you talking about? And you are the most arrogant, slow-witted, light-fingered, mercenary, immoral, reckless.
Run away with me, said Renato, and he realized he meant it.
Just like that?
She demanded.
I will, if you will.
So she kissed him. And it was the best kiss he'd ever had. They held hands as they boarded the Farfarer. Renato felt light-hearted, like the winds that were playing the rigging like a balalaika.
But Lupino...
I need to go back to Lupino, he said, suddenly realizing he could have been captured. A prisoner.
He's not.
How'd you know? He saw something in her eyes he didn't understand. He fell, didn't he? Into the abyss.
She looked away, wouldn't answer.
But then a bolt smashed through the Farfarer's keel. The broken ship plummeted out of the clouds.
Renato picked himself off the deck. They were alive.
We have to get to my private ship, she said. Do you trust me?
I guess I must, he said.
You go on ahead. Clear the path, she said. I can't kill my own soldiers.
He wanted to say that he didn't trust her, that he had no idea what he was getting into. But he had no choice, did he? He was following his heart. That's what it means to be a hero. You had to follow your heart.
Renato felt like he was ready to learn new things. Thank goodness he didn't have to go to school for that. practically sure he'd find something useful in one of these things. There were stickers all over the platform for really hot lady foxes, with pictures and addresses and everything. Time to turn it into something he could use. Their breath. It was strange to be so close to her. "What are you thinking?" he asked. "I'm trying very hard not to think." "Me too," he said. Up ahead, he could see the thin silver of Zenobia's personal ship. It looked fast. They would leave all this behind. As they reached her ship, Renato suddenly felt a sharp pain in his stomach. He was surprised to see a crossbow bolt sticking out of it.
I was going to lead the Empire to a secret base, said Lupino.
But no, you had to screw up my plan because you still got a thing for her.
Renato stared at Zenobia.
The kiss, was it real? She said, with a look of indescribable sorrow.
She gestured and said an arcane word, and Lupino went flying into the abyss, screaming,
I'm telling your father!
Then she knelt down to cradle his head, and her paws felt very soft and warm.
Okay, that was weird. He could have sworn he'd just died. Instead, he was on the Farfarer, sailing away from Ubar. And it was still burning. He'd fled burning Ubar years ago, hadn't he? And now he was back there. Had all those years fighting the Empire been nothing but a vision into the future? A useful vision, if it was true. He'd learned something. Lupino was a traitor. Renato had suspected there was something wrong with the Mad Rabbit, but now he knew there was malice behind his goofiness. He'd made bad choices. But now, when the real battle came, he wouldn't make those choices. He wouldn't make the same mistake twice. The book's pages began to flip backwards, towards the beginning. And he realized that his adventure was just beginning.